Hey, it's the Chirp with Daren Millard. Looking forward to this one. And before we get into David Quinn, just want to acknowledge incredible reaction to last week's episode and the discussion that we had with Minnesota Wild forward Ryan Hartman. It was so good and went so many different places that even Ryan's dad jumped on board as part of our social media team, tweeting it out. It also had something to do with the fact that Ryan's dad was brought up on several occasions when he was trying to teach Ryan how to kick field goals, because that was the backup plan. Ryan was going to be a place kicker or a punter if the whole hockey thing didn't work out. So we've got the dads on board, and dad will get a free hoodie whenever we get those printed out. The hoodies are coming on board for 2022. And if you subscribe, if you like, if you rate, we're going to pick some lucky people to get some of our merchandise. This week, it's the New York Rangers former coach, David Quinn, who's going to stop by. David is also scheduled to be part of Team USA's coaching staff for the Olympics. And we're looking forward to that, because he was supposed to be on the 88 team. Didn't happen. The 92 team he tried out, it didn't happen. This is finally going to be his Olympics, or will it? We'll get into that and the uncertainty involving that. Plus, David also coached our good friend Jack Eichel at Boston University for his 1 year of NCAA college. He knows Jack as well as anybody. He's going to tell Vegas fans just what you're getting in the form of Jack Eichel. And he doesn't talk in cliches, which is great, because he's going to discuss that whole Zegras Milano play. And he's going to tell you exactly what he thinks. And before you start going, it's just another old hockey guy saying it's bad, I think you got to listen to this. It's David Quinn, the New York Rangers former coach, in partnership with the NHL Coaches Association, joining us here on The Chirp with Daren Millard. You went all out with the Christmas decorations behind you. I mean, you really splurged there.
That wasn't me. It was my wife. Nothing to do with me. Believe me, I stand here and cheer her on when she puts them up.
what's this been like? Because you've had a lead up to the holidays without being behind the bench. Has it been neat? Has it been anxious? Where's your heart at right now?
I think there's a lot that goes on when you get fired for the first time and you're not coaching a hockey team for the first time in 28 years. I think you get the chance to sit back and reflect a little bit. Can't believe you're not coaching. I just think there's a lot of emotions that go on when you're in the situation that I'm in, and you try to make the most of it. You try to stay busy and, you know, stay sharp and stay in tune to the game, and the saving grace for me is the Olympic opportunity that I have, and that's kept me busy. I've been doing some work with the Olympic team and helping put the team together and stuff like that. So that certainly has kept me busy.
We'll get to the Olympics in just a second, but do you watch games every night?
I watch games, and again, watching players for the Olympics, but watching because, you know, you want to stay in tune with what's going on in the league, and if they call your number, you want to be ready and knowledgeable and hit the ground running when you get your next opportunity.
Answer this as much as you can. Do you watch teams that are struggling more than you watch teams that are playing great?
Probably teams that are doing well more than teams that aren't doing well. But depending on the night, depending on the player that I need to watch, you get a little bit of both, you know, but probably leans more towards the teams that are doing well.
Who do you think is the best team in the league right now?
That's a good question. I've really been impressed with Calgary. I know they've hit the skids a little bit. Minnesota's played very well. I know they're kind of unexpected leading the conference. Carolina's really good. Colorado's been battling injuries. They're really good. Anaheim surprised people. I wouldn't say there's one team that has really separated themselves from anybody just yet.
Yeah, it's a weird year that way because of some teams with injuries and others stepping up.
Yeah, it is. It's a different year because obviously in the COVID situation, right, teams have been depleted more so than others. So I just think there's a lot of moving parts this year, as there have been in the last 2 years. There's a lot of things that are unexpected and that you can't control, and the teams that manage those situations the best are going to be the teams that have a better chance to have success.
How long did it get you to get over being ticked off after the Rangers thing?
You mean, when will I get over it?
That's a better way to ask that question. I'm sorry. I'm going to re-ask the question. When will you get over being ticked off? Because I don't blame you.
Yeah, I just think when you're, listen, when you're a competitor and you're in our profession, you know, when you go through what I went through, there's definitely a level of anger. You know, you're frustrated and you're angry, and but that's normal, you know. And but the one thing I will say, and I've talked to a bunch of guys that have been through it, every coach who's ever coached in this league has been fired. You usually come back a better coach, and you do a lot of self-reflecting, and you know, that's something that I've done and I want to continue to do, because like I said, if I get another opportunity, I want to make sure that I'm ready and better than I've ever been.
Who'd you lean on?
You know, I've leaned on a bunch of people, obviously, you know, people in the hockey world that I'm very close to, you know, Ben Smith, Jack Parker, you know, my wife, Carrie's been huge for me, my mother, my sister, you know, close friends too. You know, I mean, those are the types of people that, that help you through difficult times, but, you know, I'm just, I'm trying to make the best of this free time.
We're not going to spend much more time on this, but one thing I will say is you did all the dirty work. That's the part that would tick me off.
Yeah. I mean, it's when you get into those situations, you kind of know what you're in for. You know, I thought we did a good job for the most part while we were there. I thought, you know, we all had kind of targeted this coming year as being the year we were probably going to be able to make a move. That being said, you know, our second year, we were when the pandemic hit, we were 1 point out of a playoff spot and probably the hottest team in the NHL the second half of the season back in 2020. And even last year, I mean, you know, right before, you know, we lose Truber and Kreider with six games to go, we're 5 points out of a playoff spot, went to go play the Islanders for two games, and we're at nine games or eight games over 500. So, you know, in a very difficult division, you know, we were the, you know, youngest team in the league and playing in a man's division with the Islanders and the Capitals and the Bruins. I mean, those are hard, hard nights. And, but, you know, I loved my time. It was an unbelievable experience. I learned an awful lot. I wish we had done a little bit better. But I think any coach feels that way. You know, you're never satisfied unless you're, you know, winning the Stanley Cup. So, you know, there's that old saying, you know, you plant the tree, but you can't sit under it and enjoy the shade. So that's life in pro sports.
Well, you can't sit under that Charlie Brown tree behind you. Like, there's no shade coming off that thing.
There's a much better tree right there.
You know? Oh, that, look at that. That is beautiful. Look at me. I'm throwing that's all right. These shots.
I was going to give you the A tree.
You know? Yeah, that was. We got Rockefeller Center over beside you, out of the frame right now. The idea of getting back behind the bench. You ready?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, very much looking forward to hopefully getting that opportunity. And, you know, I'll have that opportunity in a different role with the Olympic team. But, you know, I can't wait to get back on the ice, you know, be involved in a practice and being around a locker room and coaching a hockey team.
In getting ready for this conversation, I read that over and over you're under the umbrella of a college coach. You're not really a college. I mean, there's head coaching ability, but you've spent so much time in the National Hockey League and the professional ranks that it's a hybrid. Do you feel like you're typecasted as a college coach more than you should be?
Yes, I do. And there's nothing wrong with being a college coach. You know?
No, absolutely.
No, I know
not.
You're not. I know you're not insinuating that. I'm just saying, like, I mean, I've coached in the American League. Yeah. I've been an assistant coach in the NHL. I head coach of the U.S. national program, coached in world championships. I've been incredibly fortunate in my coaching career. You know, I think people think I've spent 28 years at Boston University.
Yes.
Because I went there and I was an assistant coach there and the head coach there. But, you know, I've spent 10 years of my coaching life at BU, 5 as the associate head coach and 5 as a head coach. And I've coached 28 years. So, you know, that's a lot of time not coaching at BU. But you know, it kind of bothered me, but I, you know, this notion that, you know, a college guy comes and it's a big jump to the National Hockey League. And I just disagree with that respectfully, because I think there's a bias there that, you know, one of the things about coaching in college hockey is you have to coach, you have to make your players better. There are no trades in college hockey. Mm-hmm. You know, you coach major, junior, you coach every other level in hockey. If things aren't going well, the player, you trade them. Well, in college, you've got to make it better. You've got to find a way as a coach to make that player the best player he can possibly be. And there are going to be obstacles. There's going to be levels of frustration. There's going to be the normal challenges that every coach faces when trying to make a player better. But you can't run away from it. You can't run away from it. You've got to coach him. You've got to find a way to make him better. And I think that gets overlooked sometimes when people talk about college coaches.
On the list of things that you bring up when you're talking to a potential opportunity, where is that all that pro experience that you had before the Rangers? Where do you bring that up?
Say that again.
Just trying to balance the college and the pro ranks and making sure that people know how much pro experience that you have.
Yeah, I think in my conversations with people that, you know, I've talked to about job opportunities and whatnot, usually they have an idea of what your background is, but I went through something this summer where I think the team I was talking to was shocked at some of the places I've been and where I've coached, because like you've alluded to, you know, people perceive me as, you know, he's just coached college hockey, which is just not true. I've been incredibly fortunate to coach at all different levels. And, you know, it's really, you know, I think it was one of the reasons why I was so confident when I took the Ranger job. I really felt like all the stops I took and all the challenges I took from, you know, head coaching the American League, assistant coach in the National Hockey League, running the U.S. national program, my experience at BU as a head coach, coaching, you know, all those elite players. I just felt like I was ready. You know, I felt like, you know, it's like you walk in to take a test and, you know, you put the work in and you know you studied, you're not nervous. And I think that, you know, all my coaching path had prepared me for that opportunity.
As we speak, the Olympics with National Hockey League participation is still a go.
Right.
Where are you in trying to evaluate everything that's happening and watching everything that's happening?
You know, it's such a personal decision when you look at what's going on in the world, and everybody has different situations. I would gather guys that aren't married that are younger or dying to go. I think guys that have families and a little bit older, maybe a little bit more cautious and asking more questions. And, you know, there's still answers that I think everybody needs to find out what will happen when we go over there. What are the protocols from if someone gets it? You know, there's a lot of talk that there's a 3 to 5 week quarantine over there. And, you know, these are all the things that I know that they're ironing out. And, you know, with what's going on in the league, with all these games getting canceled, I think there's might be a little bit more collaboration between the NHLPA and the National Hockey League on deciding what to do. And there's just so much uncertainty, as it has been for a long, long time with this disease. And, you know, I'd love to see us go, but, you know, those decisions certainly are made well above me. And I know there's an awful lot that goes into these decisions.
Will you go anyway if the NHL doesn't participate because of your freedom right now?
Yeah, nothing has been 100% concrete that will happen, but there is a plan B if the NHL guys don't go.
Okay. Because I'm looking at it and thinking, if anybody deserves to go to the Olympic Winter Games, it's David Quinn.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, I mean, look, 88, 92. I mean, come on. Yeah. 88, you had the diagnosis, the blood disorder. 92, you came back and just
wasn't good enough, but I was close. Just wasn't good enough.
Yeah, you just came up short. Like, yeah. Man, like, if anybody should be there behind that bench and working with the team, it's got to be... Are you frustrated about this now? Like, finally, you're going to go for sure. And
yeah, you know, I hate to be cliche-ish, but I don't think about the fact that we're going until we're told we're not going. I don't think about, oh boy, we may not go. I just, you can't approach it that way. You know, there's work to be done to prepare in both scenarios. You know, we've got to continue to prepare if the NHL guys are going to make sure we put the best team forward. And then, you know, if not, we've got to be prepared to send the next best group over. So, you know, I don't look at it that way. I look at it, you know, right now it's going to be an opportunity for me to go coach in the Olympics, and it's going to be an incredible experience.
Jack Eichel still wants to play in the Olympics. I don't know whether that's going to happen, whether he's healthy enough to play or whether players go, but he's told me, he's told others that it is on his radar if he can do it. Have you talked to him at all?
We have played phone tag about a month ago. We've texted a few times. I'd love to coach Jack Eichel again, that's for sure.
What is Vegas? Tell the fans, what Vegas is getting in Jack Eichel?
I think you're getting a guy who's just really about to burst. I don't think the league knows how good this guy really is. I think to the fault, I think of nobody. I think there's been a lot of circumstances in his early part of his career that have not really allowed him to probably be the player that he's capable of being. You're talking about one of the more dynamic players in the world. You know, his skating is off the charts. His sense is great. He can shoot it. You know, and he was just in a tough situation in Buffalo, and it just was, you know, the timing, unfortunately, for him. And I think he's in a situation that he is really going to blossom. And, you know, it was an unbelievable year we had together at BU. He, you know, won the Hobie Baker, and, you know, we just came up short of winning a national championship. And he was, you know, he was everything you wanted in your superstar player. He was humble. He was a great kid. He was all about the team, and it was a hell of a year. And, you know, I think in the situation he's in Vegas, I think you're going to see another level that I don't think people realize he's capable of.
What do hockey fans not know about Jack Eichel that you do?
How dedicated and how much he loves hockey. I mean, it's hockey 24/7 for this guy, and he will do anything to be the best player he can possibly be.
It impressed me how much work he put into the research on the artificial disc replacement. What was your reaction when you heard about the background?
Yeah, I'm not surprised. I mean, Jack's a bright kid. I think he's always looking to get an edge, and whether it be on or off the ice. And I think that Jack had, you know, an injury of this magnitude and the seriousness of this injury. You know, Jack didn't go to med school at BU, but I certainly imagine he is now an internet MD based on the experience he's had with his injury. So, you know, he was not going to leave any stone unturned in this process of you know, making sure he gets better and you know, not putting his career in jeopardy.
Two-pronged question. As a fan, what was your reaction when you saw the Zegras to Milano play?
It was an unbelievable play. I mean, it's incredible to watch that type of skill at the NHL level. And I know everybody calls it the Michigan play. But when it happens in the National Hockey League, it's pretty impressive. You know, talking about two very, very highly skilled players. And, you know, it was good to see Sonny Milano have the year he's having, because he's, you know, he's been a highly touted player. And, you know, sometimes people get very impatient with players. And Sonny's only 25. You know, and everyone thinks these first round picks are going to be great players the minute they step on the ice. And that's just not how it works. And, you know, he's had some injury issues. And, you know, I actually recruited Trevor Zegras to go to BU. So I know Trevor, and he's always been an elite player. And this is a guy with the utmost confidence. Swagger just falls out of him 24/7. And it was a hell of a play and a fun play for hockey.
As a coach, what was your reaction to the Zegras Milano play?
If it works, great play. If it doesn't work, don't ever do that again.
And do you have that conversation with him right after, or is it after the game? Or
no, listen, there's a balancing act of, yeah. You know, there's a balancing act of letting great players play and creativity. And, you know, I mean, I have less of a problem with plays like that happening 200 feet from your own net than I do. You know, the closer you get to your own net, you know, the practicality piece and the simplicity piece kick in hockey. You know, when you start getting closer to the offensive zone, I think you got to have to let great players play, you know? And now I also will say, I think when big boy hockey starts and the playoff starts, I think that play would have been defended a hell of a lot differently than it was the other night when that goal happened. So on top of the skill, you know, shining in that instance, I also think, you know, the lack of defensive coverage was from, yeah. This is a coach talking, you know, the defensive coverage was something that all coaches would cringe at.
One coach told me, I have way more of an issue on the defensive side than I do with the creative side on the other side of it.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
So you're analyzing creativity. You see Connor doing it, one man band. You see this other side. Can the Zegras Milano play? Can you coach that in the game? Is there a way to coach that in the game?
I think you can coach it by allowing it and encouraging it. Oh. You know, I don't think you can actually, and I, you know, everyone has skills coaches and you can improve players' skills, but you know, that stuff happens so fast. I don't know, if, you know, people don't, you know, at ice level, it's amazing how fast these guys have to think and make these decisions. So, you know, coach it per se, maybe a little bit, but in, you know, giving your players the mental freedom to play that way, I think is more the responsibility of the coach.
Do you still keep in touch with BU? 100th season, yes. Lot going on around there. How involved are you?
I mean, listen, I'm a huge supporter. It holds a special place in my heart. I'm very good friends with the coaches there and the athletic director. And, you know, I certainly follow them every weekend.
When did you have the whistle out last? Have you done any of that?
No, that was a good question. I think last time I had the whistle out was, early May was the last time I had the whistle out. Yeah.
I have to admit, I was a little intimidated coming on here because you have good flow. So I had to make sure I had to spend a couple of extra minutes getting my flow.
Not today.
Going.
I don't have good flow today.
but I'm happy that at least I'm in the league with you right now. I've never met you, and it's one of the few coaches that I haven't had an in-person conversation, and I was looking forward to this. This has been fun. I've really enjoyed this, and I wish you.
I have too.
Nothing but the greatest success, and I do hope you get to go to China, no matter what happens. To see that tracksuit up there would be a dream come true, knowing what you've been through. So thanks for doing this, David.
I appreciate it. Great talking to you, and hopefully we'll see you in an NHL rink sometime soon.
That would be great. I'll buy you the coffee. Thanks, buddy.
Awesome. All right.
That was cool. I love it, and I will make sure that Ben Cook, who does all of our video stuff, is going to ensure that people get to see the Charlie Brown tree behind David and then the real tree, like the Rockefeller tree that's in his house. Because I know it's an audio podcast. A lot of people listen to the audio portion, but seeing these people in their homes and the way they relax and be able to just share some of their behind the scenes stuff is neat. The Charlie Brown tree was like, what do you do with that thing during the year? Do you just put it in the backyard and hope it doesn't just fall over? David Quinn, best of luck to you. I've got some Christmas wishes, some holiday Christmas gift ideas for everybody. And I'm going to give the Buffalo Sabres just a strong 2022, all right? I don't care if the Buffalo Sabres make the playoffs. I don't need them to win three rounds. I just hope that there's positivity around the Buffalo Sabres in the year 2022. I'm also going to gift the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Edmonton Oilers one playoff victory, a round, not a victory. Although last year, the Edmonton Oilers got swept in the first round. So I'm going to give both teams, Connor McDavid, Austin Matthews, one playoff round. After that, it's all up to you. Tampa Bay, going back to the Stanley Cup final. I want to see a true dynasty. So I'm gifting the Tampa Bay Lightning a third consecutive trip to the Stanley Cup final. Not going to just award them three straight championships, but a third trip to the Stanley Cup final, unprecedented in the salary cap era. And to all of us, to Ben, to producer Bob, and to all of you, I am going to wish that we get an 82-game schedule and a full Stanley Cup playoffs. I know goodwill to men and all that stuff, like good tidings and beautiful memories and health, and it's all important. But I want an 82-game schedule. That's what I want to everybody. Thanks to David Quinn for stopping by. Really cool. He should be back in the game, and I think he will be very soon because he's just that good of a coach and did all the grunt work with the New York Rangers, and positive about that outlook. Have a great holiday season. We'll be back with you one more time before 2022 on the Chirp Podcast with Daren Millard. Subscribe, like, hit that, smash that button that gives us all the support, and there'll maybe be a hoodie coming your way.